نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. يتفضل شيخنا فضيلة الشيخ علي الحلبي بمحاضرة مهمة في هذه الندوة بعنوان أهمية التمسك بالسنة في الغرب. الشيخ علي حفظه الله is giving a talk with the title The Importance of Adhering to the Sunnah in the West.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أما بعد، فإني أبتدئ هذا المجلس الكريم بالتعليق على عنوان المحاضرة لأنطلق منه إلى مضمونها، فعنوانها أهمية التمسك بالسنة في الغرب. والسنة إذا أطلقت في هذا المقام فالمراد الغالب منها هو السنة النبوية والتمسك بالهدي النبوي. وأنا أرى أن التركيز على المعنى الأعم للسنة الذي هو الشريعة يكون في هذا المقام أشمل من ذكر السنة فقط، فإن الإخوة الحاضرين أجمعين إن شاء الله هم من أهل السنة النبوية ومن الدعاة إليها ومن الراغبين بها ومن المجتمعين عليها، فالتذكير بأمر يعرفونه ويعيشون له وعليه يكون الأولى منه التذكير بالشريعة كلها فقها وسلوكا وعبادة وعقيدة. والنبي عليه الصلاة والسلام عندما علم عن أولئك النفر الثلاثة الذين نزلوا بيوت أزواجه وقد عمد كل واحد منهم إلى شأن من شؤون الإسلام ليفعله على صورة ليست على سنة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، فكان الأول يصوم ولا يفطر، وكان الثاني يقوم الليل ولا ينام، وكان الثالث لا يريد أن يتزوج النساء. فلما بلغ الخبر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: أما أنا فأصوم وأفطر وأقوم وأرقد وأتزوج النساء، فمن رغب عن سنتي فليس مني. فسنتي ها هنا أي هدي وشريعتي الشاملة الكاملة التي منها التسنن بهدي السنة والتأدب بآدابها. وأما ما ورد في عنوان المحاضرة أيضا من تخصيص ذلك بالغرب، فأنا أقول السنة سنة والأهمية أهمية، فالشرق والغرب فيها سواء، والتمسك في مكة كالتمسك في عمان، كالتمسك في الجزائر، كالتمسك في الصومال، كالتمسك في مصر، في السودان، في انجلترا، في امريكا. لكن قد يكون التخصيص لذكر الغرب ها هنا مرادا به شيء اخر، وهو بيان الاسباب المعينة على التمسك بالسنة، وهذا الذي ينبغي التركيز عليه في هذه المحاضرة. وهذا ما عقدت العزم بتوفيق الله أن يكون هو مدار مجلسنا.
All praise is due to Allah. We praise Him, we seek His help, and we ask for His forgiveness. We seek refuge in Allah from the evils of ourselves and the evils of our actions. Whomsoever Allah guides, none can misguide, and whomsoever Allah misguides, none can guide. And I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah alone, who has no partner. And I bear witness that Muhammad is His slave and messenger. Indeed, the best speech is the book of Allah, and the best guidance is that of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the worst thing in the religion are the newly invented matters, and all the newly invented matters are innovation, and all innovation is misguidance, and all misguidance is in the fire. The Shaykh Hafidhullah said, I commence this talk and this gathering by giving a brief comment on the title of this lecture, and from there we will start to deal with the points that we have to deal with under this title. This lecture is entitled The Importance of Adhering to the Sunnah in the West. And the word as-sunnah, when it is mentioned generally in that sense, it refers to the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to adhering to the prophetic guidance. And the Shaykh hafidhullah sees that what should be done is to focus on the general meaning of as-sunnah, which is the sharia that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with in its entirety. Alhamdulillah, the brothers who are attending today, they are from the people of As-Sunnah, and from the people who call to As-Sunnah, and who are so keen to implement the Sunnah and gather upon it, and reminding them of something that they know quite well, and they pay attention to take care of, has not got precedence over reminding them of the Sharia with its entirety, with everything that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with, in terms of implementing it, acting upon it, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and having the correct aqidah. When the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard of the three people who came to his house, and each one of them dealt with something from the religion or from the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or approached it in a way that was never narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself. The first one said, I fast and I never break my fast, so I fast every day. The second one would pray all night and would never go to sleep. And the third one would never marry women. So when the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard this, when the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard that, he said, as for me, I fast and I break my fast on other days. I stand up at night for prayer, and sometimes I go to sleep, and I marry women. So whoever turns away or turns to other than my sunnah, then he is not free, he is not from me, or I am free from him. So when the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in this statement, whoever turns away from my sunnah or aspires other than my sunnah, then he was referring to the sharia that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with, which is adhering to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in all affairs and sticking to the manners of prophethood. What was mentioned in the title of this lecture as well, which is specifying the West, the importance of adhering to the sunnah in the West, specifying the West, The Shaykh Hafizullah is saying, Sunnah, we remain always the Sunnah wherever we are. And its importance and its precedence over other issues is the same wherever we are and in whenever or in any time we live. So whether we are in the East or the West, adhering to the Sunnah is the same. Whether we are in Mecca, in Amman, in Algeria, in Somalia, in Egypt, in Sudan, in the UK or the USA. But the Shaykh says that specifying the West in the title of this lecture, it has certain significance, which is showing and manifesting the means that help the person adhere to the Sunnah and stick to it in the West. So this is what the Shaykh Hafizahullah is going to focus on and expound upon is in this lecture, which is to explain the reasons or the means that help the person to stick to the Sunnah.
فإن أهم الأسباب المعينة على التمسك بالسنة عموما سواء أكان ذلك في الشرق أم في الغرب أسباب كثيرة قد جمعت منها 10 أسباب وإذا فات بعض فلا يخلو أن يكون جزءا منها أو راجعا إليها. نعم قد يتأكد التركيز على هذه الأسباب والأخذ بها في الغرب أكثر من الشرق بسبب الغربة المتنوعة، غربة الديار وغربة الدين وغربة السنة بين المسلمين، فهي غربة في غربة في غربة. أقول بسبب هذه الغربة المضاعفة المركبة قد تزداد أهمية التركيز على هذه الأسباب العشرة في بلاد الغرب أكثر من الشرق. فأول ذلك العلم. نحن لا نريد لإخواننا أن يكون مثل هذا الجمع المبارك فقط عند قدوم الإخوة من طلبة العلم وأهل العلم إليكم، وهذا اجتماع يسر الخاطر ويفرح النفس ويزيد المحبة والأخوة، نعم، لكن أن يكون هذا الاجتماع موسميا فهذا ليس بجيد. نحن نريد أن يكون الاجتماع للعلم دوريا في كل أسبوع مرة أو مرتين، يجتمع الإخوة فيما بينهم يتذاكرون العلم. ولا أريد أن أبين فضل العلم، فكما ذكرت بشأن السنة أكرره بشأن العلم، فالكل ولله الحمد من الحاضرين يعرف للعلم فضله وقدره. ومن هنا جاء مفرغا النفس ومتجشما السفر ومفارقا المنزل والدار لينال شيئا من العلم على الأقل يذكره. وأهل العلم يقولون إحياء العلم مذاكرته. وأذكر هذا الأثر مسبقا لأجيب به على ما قد يرد على بعض الأذهان عندما يقول بعض الإخوة لا يوجد بيننا عالم نجتمع عليه. نقول وهذا من مآسي هذا الواقع الذي ابتليتم به وابتلي بكم أعاننا الله وإياكم، ولكن الخروج منه يجب أن يكون بالقدر المستطاع. اتقوا الله ما استطعتم. فالعلماء عندما قالوا إحياء العلم مذكرته لا يلزم أن يكون هنالك عالم وطلاب، حتى لو كان هنالك إخوة متقاربون فيما بينهم بالعلم وتذاكروا العلم وذكروا به لكان هذا خيرا، ولأثمر هذا منهم طلبة علم متقدمين ينتفعون بهم وينفعون أنفسهم وينفعون الآخرين منهم. فإن من أهم الأسباب وأولها إذن العلم.
Sheikh Hafizahullah goes on to say that one of the main reasons that helps the Muslim adhere to the Sunnah generally, whether he lives in the East or the West, there are many reasons, and the Sheikh Hafizahullah summarized or gathered 10 of them. And these 10, they cover the main reasons that help the person adhere to the Sunnah, and if there are any other reasons, then they fall under one of these 10. We have to focus on these means that will help us adhere to the Sunnah, and there is more significance and more necessity to adhere and to implement these 10 means, especially for those who are living in the West, as the feeling of strangeness, of being strange, is multiplied in the West for those who are strangers in this country. So they are far from their homeland, and the feeling of estrangement when it comes to the religion of Al-Islam, and the feeling of estrangement for those who adhere to the Sunnah from amongst the Muslims, so it is a feeling of estrangement that is engulfed by more and multiplied estrangement. Due to that, there is dire need to adhere to these 10 means that lead us to stick to the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, especially for those living in the West. The first means, and one of the most important, is knowledge. And the Shaykh Hafizahullah is saying, we don't want for this gathering only to take place when the students of knowledge and the people of knowledge come to this country and meet with the people. Rather, such gatherings should be regular, should always take place among the brothers, as these gatherings bring happiness to the heart and it increases mutual love and the sense of brotherhood amongst the brothers. So this should not be confined to the time where the scholars come or to certain times or seasons. Rather, it should be a regular practice. So we have to stick to this at least one time or twice a week. The brothers gather together in order to study together and mention some points of benefit of knowledge, and they study it together, especially as, alhamdulillah, the majority of the brothers here are aware of the merit and the importance and the high status of knowledge in the religion of Al-Islam. And as the Shaykh Abdullah explained about the Sunnah, that alhamdulillah, everyone here seems to be aware of the importance of the Sunnah and the position of the Sunnah. Most of us know the position of knowledge in the religion of Al-Islam. This is why people came from different parts in this country or other countries, in order to sit before the people of knowledge to learn from them, and they left their homes and their families in order to spend a couple of days here studying and benefiting from the scholars. This is why the people of knowledge said, we revive knowledge by studying it. We revive knowledge by studying it. And the Shaykh Abdullah said, I mention this statement from the scholars in order to give an answer in advance to an expected question that will come from some brothers, that they will say, we don't have any scholars here to come and learn the knowledge from. So the Shaykh Abdullah gives the answer that this is the sad reality of the people who are living in the West. But we have to deal with it, and the only way that we keep ourselves safe is we do what we can, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and fear Allah to the best of your ability. It is not necessary that there should be a scholar and students of knowledge with him. Rather, if there are brothers who are close to one another, they gather together to study and to attain more knowledge. There's a lot of goodness in that, and this will produce, inshallah, in the future, students of knowledge who are well firm and established upon knowledge, who will benefit themselves and benefit the others. So one of the main means to adhering to the sunnah in the West is knowledge and seeking it.
وأما السبب الثاني فهو الدعوة. قدمت العلم على الدعوة لأن الدعوة لا تقوم إلا بالعلم ولا تبنى إلا على العلم، بخلاف كثير من المناهج والدعوات والجماعات والأحزاب المنتسبة إلى الإسلام والسنة، وهي للأسف بعيدة عن السنة، حيث تدعو بغير علم، وإنما تدعو بالتقليد، وتدعو بالعاطفة، وتدعو بالتكتل والتهييج دون العلم والتعلم والتعليم الذي هو أصل أصول الإسلام. وبوب الإمام البخاري في صحيحه في كتاب العلم، قال: باب العلم قبل القول والعمل. ثم ذكر قول الله تبارك وتعالى: فاعلم أنه لا إله إلا الله واستغفر لذنبك. قال: فبدأ بالعلم قبل القول والعمل. وهذه الدعوة قسمان فيما أرى وأتصور. أما الأول فهو الدعوة للمؤلفين، فالنبي عليه الصلاة والسلام عندما أوحى إليه رب العالمين بالرسالة قال أول ما قال: فأنذر عشيرتك الأقربين، ثم بعد ذلك: وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين للناس كافة. فإن المسلم أول ما يحرص على المؤلفين، وهؤلاء المؤلفون أقسام: عليك بالأقرب فالأقرب، عليك بالأسرة من زوجة وولد ووالد وشقيق، ثم الجار، وهكذا الأقرب فالأقرب، أدناك أدناك. هذا الذي ينبغي أن يكون التركيز عليه. أما أن نقفز بعيدا مخلفين وراءنا الأقربين منا، فهذا ليس هو النهج المرضي ولا السلوك السوي. فالواجب البدء بالدعوة في هؤلاء الأقربين. كذلك أيضا الدعوة للزملاء، زملاء العمل، زملاء الدراسة، قبل أن يؤثروا عليك، أن تؤثر عليهم، قبل أن تنجر إلى الباطل الذي قد يكون بعضهم متلبسا به، تدنيهم من الحق الذي وفقك الله إليه. وهكذا الأخلاء يومئذ بعضهم لبعض عدو إلا المتقين. ثم الدعوة للمخالف، والمخالف قسمان في هذه البلاد بل في كل البلاد. الأول هم غير المسلمين، والثاني هم المسلمون غير السنيين. فأيضا يجب على فئة من طلبة العلم والدعاة إلى الله في هذه البلاد ممن هم أهل لذلك، وأؤكد على هذه الجزئية، ممن هم أهل لذلك، إذ إن البعض قد تدفعه حماسته وغيرته للذهاب إلى بعض المخالفين هؤلاء، ثم إذا به يتأثر بشبهاتهم، كما قال الحسن البصري: لا تمكن صاحب بدعة من أذنيك لئلا يورث في قلبك شبهة. قال الذهبي معلقا: نعم صدق، فالقلوب ضعيفة والشبه خطاصة. فلا يقترب من أولئك إلا طلبة العلم الواثقون الذين يزكيهم إخوانهم بأن يذهبوا إلى أولئك النفر وأن ينصحوهم ويذكروهم وأن يناظروهم. ومن حمد الله ومنته أن جل المخالفين جهلة وبعيدون عن العلم وأسانيدهم منقطعة عن العلماء، فالصولة والجولة لأهل السنة ولطلبة العلم مهما ضاقت الحلقات ومهما ضاقت السبل فستتوسع وتنفتح ويرجع الحق والنصرة به لأهل السنة ولو بعد حين. ولكن الأمر متعلق بنا نحن في ضعفنا وفي وهاء ما عندنا على ما فيه من نعمة لم نعرف لها قدرها. فالدعوة لهؤلاء النفر من المخالفين سواء كانوا غير مسلمين أم غير سنيين إنما تكون من أهل الثقة الذين يوثقهم إخوانهم وينتدبونه للقيام بهذا الواجب.
The second means that helps the Muslims stick to the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is da'wah. And the Shaykh hafidhahullah says that I put knowledge before da'wah because da'wah should be based upon knowledge and can never be based except upon knowledge. This is unlike the other methodologies and the other groups and the other calls that ascribe themselves to Islam and ascribe themselves to the Sunnah while they are far away from the true meaning of a Sunnah. They call to Islam based upon blind following, based upon emotion, based upon gathering together, based upon tackling the emotions of the people without knowledge and without studying, while knowledge is one of the foundations or is the main foundation in Islam. This is why al-Bukhari in his Sahih, in the book of knowledge, put the heading chapter knowledge comes before speech and action. Then he mentioned the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ. Know that there is none worthy of worship except Allah, then seek for forgiveness. So he said he started with knowledge before speech and action. Da'wah falls into two types, as the Shaykh Habibullah puts it. The first one, calling those who are close to us and who are or who agree with our da'wah. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with when he ordered him to call first the closer to him from his tribe. And after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him that we sent you as a mercy to the world and to the people or to the whole of humanity. So the first thing that the Muslim, or the first people that the Muslim should pay attention to with regards to giving da'wah is those who are closest to him. His family, his wife, his children, his father, his mother, his friends, his neighbors. So this is what the first thing that has or the thing that has the utmost priority when it comes to da'wah. And then after that, he will go to give da'wah to those who come after them. And one should under that call his friends, his colleagues at work, those who study with him before they affect him with their evil. So if they have evil, before that evil gets the chance to corrupt him, he should take precedence and he should take the initiative in order to spread the good and spread it amongst those around him. The second type of da'wah is da'wah to those who oppose this da'wah or who oppose this call. And This in turn falls into two types. First, calling the non-Muslims. And second one, calling the Muslims who do not follow the Sunnah. So it is an obligation upon a group from the students of knowledge and those who call to Allah and those who are qualified to give da'wah. And it is not for those who are moved and who are motivated by their emotions and by their own desires in order to fit with those who oppose the true da'wah. And the result of that is that they get corrupted, they get contaminated, and they receive the innovations and they absorb it and they become affected by it. Rather, it should be the people who are firm upon this knowledge. Because this is why Al-Hasan al-Basri said, never lend your ears to someone who calls to his desires or calls to innovation, because this will definitely soak or definitely find its way or will creep into your heart. So Al-Dhahabi, once he heard this statement, he said, that's true, because the hearts are weak and the doubts are snatching, they snatch the heart. So the students of knowledge who are well established on knowledge, who are recommended by the scholars, they are the ones who should approach the people who are not upon the Sunnah, the people of innovation and desires. They are the ones who should approach them, advise them, remind them, and maybe debate with them. And alhamdulillah, the majority of those who oppose this true da'wah are far from knowledge and are soaked with ignorance. And they are so far from the scholars. So power and authority in this field is for the students of knowledge and the people of knowledge. And even if things get hard for them, at the end, the truth will prevail and the truth will be victorious. But the only thing that holds our da'wah back is our own weaknesses as people, the weaknesses of our own souls, because we don't really know the true worth of the favor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala favored us with, which is the true religion of Islam. So calling those who oppose us should be performed and should be carried out by those who are well established upon knowledge and who are recommended by the scholars.
والسبب الثالث ذكر الله، لأن ذكر الله تبارك وتعالى من أسباب التوفيق. اذكروني أذكركم، ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب. وعندما جاء ذلك الرجل إلى رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام استوصيه، ماذا قال له رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام؟ أوصاه، قال: ألا يزال لسانك رطبا بذكر الله. فأن يكون العبد ذاكرا لربه تبارك وتعالى في أذكار الصباح والمساء، في أذكار الدخول والخروج، في أذكاره في يومه وليلته، فإن هذا من أعظم السبل التي تعينه على الثبات وتعينه على الاستمرار والاستقرار وتعينه على التمسك بالسنة. فإن السنة لا يستطيع أحد أن يمسك بها دفعة واحدة، وإنما يتمسك بها بقدر ما يوفقه الله إليها، فإذا به يمسك جملتها ليكون من أهلها والدعاة إليها، ليكون قائما بها ومن حماتها. فذكر الله تبارك وتعالى من أعظم الأسباب المعينة على ذلك.
The second means that helps the Muslim adhere to the Sunnah is remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As remembrance of Allah is one of the reasons that bring the person or bring the Muslim to success. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ, and remember me and I will remember you. That means that Allah will always take care of us. And أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ, verily only with the remembrance of Allah the heart feel at rest. And this is why when man came to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam seeking advice, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, let your tongue be moisted or remain moisted with the remembrance of Allah. So that means you should take to remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all times. So if the person or the Muslim remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala making the adhkar of the morning and the evening and entering the house and leaving it and all the other remembrances that are recorded from the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is one of the best means that helps the person remain steadfast and strong and adhering to the sunnah in all his affairs. And when it comes to adhering to the sunnah, no one can hold on to it with its entirety, completely. Rather, the person should seek the help of Allah, and Allah will grant him and help him to hold on to a great deal of the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is how the person becomes one of the people of a sunnah, defending it, implementing it and acting upon it. So remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one of the main means that support the person and help him adhere to the sunnah.
وأيضا من الأسباب المعينة على ذلك العبادة الحقة. يقول الله تبارك وتعالى وما أمروا إلا ليعبدوا الله مخلصين له الدين. ويقول الله تبارك وتعالى وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون. ويقول الله تبارك وتعالى قل إن صلاتي ونسكي ومحياي ومماتي لله رب العالمين لا شريك له وبذلك أمرت وأنا أول المسلمين. فالعبادة كلمة لها معنيان، معنى عام ومعنى خاص. فالمعنى العام شامل لكل ما تفعله وتقوله يا عبد الله، كما قال شيخ الإسلام العبادة اسم جامع لكل ما يحبه الله ويرضاه من الأقوال والأفعال ظاهرها وباطنها. والمعنى الخاص هو المتعلق بأركان الإسلام من الشهادتين والصلاة والصيام والزكاة والحج الواردة في حديث ابن عمر وغيره. بني الإسلام على خمس: شهادة أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمدا رسول الله وإقام الصلاة وإيتاء الزكاة وصوم رمضان وحج البيت من استطاع إليه سبيلا. وهذا كله منه ما هو فرض ومنه ما هو نفل. والنبي عليه الصلاة والسلام يقول فيما يرويه عن ربه: ولا يزال عبدي يتقرب إلي بالنوافل حتى أحبه، فإذا أحببته كنت سمعه الذي يسمع به وبصره الذي يبصر به ويده التي يبطش بها ورجله التي يمشي بها، ولئن سألني لأجيبنه ولئن استنصرني لأنصرنه. هكذا يكون العبد المؤمن في قيامه بهذه العبادة التي لها في مواضع الفتنة أجر مضاعف، كما في صحيح مسلم عن أبي هريرة أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: العبادة في الهرج كهجرة إلي. فالعبادة في المواضع التي تغيب فيها العقول وتذهب فيها الأذهان وتكثر فيها الفتن أجرها مضاعف، لأن الناس يكونون منشغلين بالفتن والمحن، والمسلم من منشغل بربه بعبادته بواجبه الملقى على عواتقه يؤدي فيه حقه ويسأل فيه ربه. فالعبادة بهذا المعنى أيضا من أهم الأسباب المعينة على التمسك بالسنة بمفهوميها العام والخاص.
The fourth means that helps or that helps the Muslim adhere to the Sunnah is worshipping Allah as He truly deserves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, and they were not ordered except that they worship Allah, making the religion sincerely for Him. And in another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and I have not created the jinn and mankind except that they should worship Me. In another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, say, O Muhammad, my prayer, my sacrifice, my life and my death are all for Allah, who has no partners, and this is what I was commanded with, and I am the first of the Muslimin. And al-ibadah is a general word, or a big word, that has two meanings. One general meaning, which means, or which includes and covers everything that you do, O Muslim. Everything you do and everything you say. And this is the meaning implied by Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah when he defined the word al-ibadah, worship, by saying that it is a general word that encompasses and covers everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with, whether from speeches or actions, whether inward or outward actions or speeches. And there's a special meaning or a particular meaning which refers to the five pillars of Islam, which are narrated in the hadith of Ibn Umar, where he said Islam is built upon five pillars, testifying that none is worthy of worship except Allah, and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, and establishing the prayer, giving zakah, and fasting Ramadan, and performing hajj for those who are able to. And worship in this specific meaning covers the obligation and the optional acts of worship. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, where he narrates from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he said, and my servant keeps doing more of the optional acts of worship and seeks nearness to Me with that until I become his hearing that he hears with, and his sight that he sees with, and his hand with which he hits, and his foot which he walks with. And if he asks me, then I will answer. I will grant him what he asks for. And if he asks me for victory, then I will give him victory. So, as the believing servant performs the worship for Allah, sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially at the time of fitna and at the time of trials, then there will be multiplied reward for that worship, as narrated in Sahih Muslim from the hadith of Abi Hurairah, where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the time of trial and at the time where a lot of bloodshed will be and killing, it is like performing hijrah towards Me. So worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sticking to that at the times where the minds of people are deluded, and due to the abundance of fitna and of trials and of hardships, there will be multiplied reward for that type of worship, because at the time of fitna, people are so busy and are so taken and deluded by the fitna to the extent that they turn away from their Lord and from the duty for which they were created, which is worshipping Allah, whilst the Muslim is busy with worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is busy with performing and fulfilling his duty towards his Lord, and he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save him and to protect him. So worship in this sense, or in this particular or specific meaning, is, or with both meanings, the general and the specific ones, both of them help the Muslim adhere to the Sunnah wherever he is.
وأيضا من الأسباب المعينة على ذلك التزام الهدي الظاهر من اللحية والسنة وغطاء الرأس والثوب الإسلامي، فإن هذه أمور مهمة لأنها من المعينات على الثبات ومن المظهرات للسنة. فإذا كان ذلك مهما في بلاد المسلمين فإن أهميته هنا أكثر، لأنك في التزامك وهديك تنال شيئين: الأول التميز، والثاني الدعوة حتى ولو كنت ساكتا. فالدعوة بالقدوة لها أهميتها ولها مكانتها. فكيف إذا عرفنا أن للظاهر صلة كبرى بالباطن، وأن التشبه بالظواهر له أثر على البواطن؟ النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام عندما كان يقف في الصف كان يقول: لتسون صفوفكم أو ليخالفن الله بين وجوهكم. تسوية الصفوف أمر متعلق بالأبدان، وعدم ضبطه يجعله متعلقا بالقلوب. لماذا؟ لتلكم الصلة المرتبطة المترابطة المنضبطة بين الظاهر والباطن. فأنت يا عبد الله عندما تكون ملتزما بالهدي الظاهر ومنور الوجه بالسنة ومنور المحيا بالسنة، تكون داعيا إلى الله في سكونك، في صمتك، في خضوعك، في غضك بصرك، في حفظك لسانك، في مشيك. فكيف إذا كان منك كلام وقول ودعوة مع العلم الذي أشرنا إليه وأكدنا عليه؟ يكون ذلك أولى وأولى. وإني لا أعلم من كثير من الناس، معذرة، ممن يحافظون على أزيائهم القومية، كل يحافظ على زي بلده، ولكنهم بالمقابل لا يحافظون على الهدي الظاهر الذي هو أولى وأولى وفيه الأجر والمثوبة. بينما ذاك يعني إذا أسأنا الظن قد يكون باب تعصب، ونرجو أن لا يكون. فالمسلم الحريص الراغب بالحق يحرص لنفسه ولإخوانه على التمسك بالهدي الظاهر لما في ذلك من آثار وإيجابيات كبيرة وكبيرة جدا، تؤدي إلى مزيد من التمسك بالسنة وبخاصة في هذه البلاد.
Another means that helps the Muslim adhere to the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to stick to the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam with regard to the way we look, to the beard, and the way the Muslim dresses himself according to the Sunnah and covering the head. These are very important issues, and they are a great support for the Muslim to be steadfast and remain strong and firm upon the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is very important in the Muslim countries, and it is even more important in the West. And by adhering to the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in our outward manner, there are two benefits, or two main benefits. The first one is being distinct from the kuffar. Second one is giving da'wah, even if you are silent. So the da'wah, by our example, is very important, especially in these countries. So how if we come to know that the way we look or the way we dress ourselves has to do much with our inward manner, with our heart, and that the way the person dresses himself and the way he behaves himself affects his heart and affects his inward manner. This is clear in the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whenever he was straightening the line when the people were praying behind him, he would say, "You shall straighten your lines or Allah shall create enmity and dissension amongst your faces or amongst you. So an act like straightening the lines in the prayer, it has to do with the body, has to do with the outward practice of the person, but it has strong connection and it is highly related to the hearts of the people. So once we adhere to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam outwardly, and once the person shows the sunnah to the people and declares it to everyone, then he is calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if he is silent and wherever he goes, and with his lowering his gaze and with his protecting his tongue from evil speech, and even with the way and the manner he walks and behaves himself wherever he goes. So, and if he speaks and calls the people to Islam, then this will be goodness over goodness. And this is really strange and astonishing that many people stick to their traditions, to the national way of dressing themselves. And this always comes from this sticking to their national way of dressing themselves has nothing to do with the sunnah. Rather, they stick to their national dresses, but they never dress themselves, or they never stick to the way the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam would dress himself, or the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam would do so. So all this might be from prohibited kind of alliance or allegiance to one's own country or one's own origins. And rather, the Muslim who really seeks the truth, he should be keen to implement himself and to call his brothers and urge them to implement the sunnah inwardly and outwardly, due to the advantages in all aspects when it comes to adhering to the sunnah in that manner.
Just a small quick announcement for the sisters. News has reached us that the children are making a lot of noise there and disturbing the other sisters that want to listen and benefit from this conference. So please, those sisters that have children, please don't let them fight, please don't let them make noise, look after them, and if you cannot stop them from making noise, then please take them upstairs into the creche and look after them yourselves. Jazakum Allah khair.
قد ذكرنا خمسة من الأسباب على وجه التفصيل، ولمقتضى الوقت وضيقه نذكر الخمسة الأسباب الباقية على وجه الإجمال. فمن أهمها صلاة الجماعة، المحافظة على صلاة الجماعة من الأمور المهمة التي ينبغي أن يحافظ عليها الإخوة المسلمون في بلاد الغرب، لأنها كالسياج الواقي وكالحصن الحامي، تحافظ بها على نفسك، وإن الشيطان يأكل من الذئب، وإن الذئب يأكل من الغنم القاصية. فالمحافظة على صلاة الجماعة تعين الإنسان على الثبات وعلى التمسك بالسنة. أيضا من الأمور الاتفاق على حل المنازعات بالشرع، فإن كثيرا من الناس يدخل الشيطان بينهم، إن الشيطان ينزغ بينهم، فإذا اتفقنا اتفاقا إنجاز التعبير أدبيا وخلقيا، فضلا عن أن يكون دينيا وإيمانيا، أن يكون سبيل حل منازعاتنا كلها الكتاب والسنة، لكان ذلك من أعظم الأمور أيضا التي تعيننا على الالتزام بالكتاب والسنة. أما أن تكون أسباب منازعاتنا الهوى وأن تكون طرائق الخروج من منازعاتنا أيضا الهوى، فكيف يكون منا سنة أو تمسك بالسنة أو دعوة للسنة؟ أيضا من الأمور الصحبة الصالحة، المرء على دين خليله، وذكرنا قوله تعالى الأخلاء يومئذ بعضهم لبعض عدو إلا المتقين. إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات سيجعل لهم الرحمن ودا. الحب في الله والبغض في الله أوثق عرى الإيمان. صديقك من صدقك، الصحبة الصالحة أعظم إعانة على البر والتقوى. ومن واجبات مستحقات الصحبة الصالحة السبب التاسع، وهو التواصي بالحق والتواصي بالصبر والتناصح. الله عز وجل نعى على بني إسرائيل أنهم كانوا لا يتناهون عن منكر فعلوه، وهو مثل سوء نأخذ منه العبرة والحذر ألا نكون مثله. ويلزم من ذلك شيء متضمن، بل شيئان. الشيء الأول عدم انشغال الإخوة بما لا فائدة منه وبما لا جدوى تحته. نرى بعض المجالس وبعض السهرات يأخذ القول في أمور لا جدوى منها حيزا كبيرا. لماذا؟ هذا ليس من حق الصحبة أن تضيع الساعات، ولا أريد أن أقول الدقائق والثواني واللحظات. وما الشيء الثاني فهو أن تحرصوا على ألا تستوردوا المشاكل. نعم، مثل المؤمنين في توادهم وتراحمهم كمثل الجبل، لكن يكفيكم ما أنتم فيه. فتنة ابتلي بها أهل الشر، وهذه الفتنة لا توجد عندكم لا في حقيقتها ولا في وجودها ولا في ثمرتها ولا في أدنى شيء منها، ما لكم ولها. لماذا نحرص على أن نكون صورة طبق الأصل عما يجري هنالك في البلاء والشر والفتنة والفرقة، ولا نحرص على ذلك في الخير والهدى والتواصي بالحق والصبر والمرحمة؟ وأما النقطة الأخيرة فهي الاستعلاء بالإسلام. ثلاث من كن فيه وجد بهن حلاوة الإيمان: أن يكون الله ورسوله أحب إليه مما سواهما، وأن يحب المرء لا يحبه إلا لله، وأن يكره أن يرجع إلى الكفر بعد إذ أنقذه الله منه، كما يكره أن يقذف في النار. هذه صفة المستعلي بإيمانه. من اجتمعت فيه هذه الصفات كلها كان مستعليا بإيمانه، مرتفعا بالتزامه، كما قال الله: قل هذه سبيلي أدعو إلى الله، قل من غير استحياء ولا مواربة ولا استخفاء ولا ضعف ولا وهن، بل بقوة وثبات ورفعة. أن يستعلي المؤمن بإيمانه، هذا الاستعلاء النفساني المنعكس على الجوارح وعلى القول والعمل هو من أعظم أسباب الثبات، ومن أعظم وجوه التمسك بسنة النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. وفي هذا القدر كفاية، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
الشيخ حفظه الله said that we mentioned five of the means that help the Muslim remain steadfast upon the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We explained them in detail. And as for the remaining five, we're going to mention them briefly as we are running out of time. The six means that helps the Muslim stick to the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to pay attention to Salat al-Jama'ah, the congregational prayer. And it's a very important issue. Once we establish the prayer in Jama'ah, in the Masjid, it is a protection, a shield that protects the Muslim and protects his religion. And as in the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the wolf eats from the sheep, that one which is away from the herd. So establishing the prayer in congregation is one of the main reasons that help the Muslim stick to the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The seventh means is to sort out any dispute that takes place or that happens between the Muslims by referring to the Quran and the Sunnah, by referring to the Sharia. Many people, they fall in dispute and disagreement. And this is all from the works of Shaitan, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that Shaitan will always strive to create enmity amongst the Muslims. So, if we strike a deal or give a word to our brothers, we stick to it, we adhere to it and abide by it. And if any kind of dispute or disagreement happens, we refer to the Quran and the Sunnah. And this is the only thing that helps us abide by the Sunnah and remain steadfast upon it. But as for those who refer to their own desires and depend upon their own inclinations and their own interests in order to sort out any kind of disagreement or dispute among the brothers, then how can this lead them or make them remain steadfast upon the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, let alone calling to it? The eighth means that help the Muslim remain steadfast upon the Sunnah is keeping good company. To spend his time with good brothers. As the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, a person is upon the religion as his closest friend. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran that all friends on the Day of Judgment will be enemies to one another, except for those who are pious or righteous. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, those who believed and did righteous deeds, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will create amongst them love and affection. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, loving for Allah and hating for Allah is from the firm handholds in the religion of Islam. And in another narration, your true friend is the one who is truthful towards you. So the good company is one of the main aids and points that support the person and keep him upon righteousness and upon piety. So, and from the obligations upon the Muslim brother towards his Muslim brothers is the ninth, or the means number nine that the Shaykh mentioned, which is to enjoin one another with the truth and enjoin one another with patience, which is mutual advice amongst the Muslims. And what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemned the children of Israel for is that they did not prevent one another or stop one another from falling into munkar and into sin. So this is a bad example that we should shun and take a lesson from. And there are two points that follow from enjoining the truth and enjoining patience, which is giving advice to our brothers. The first one is that the brothers should not spend their time with things that are not beneficial for them. So we see many gatherings, many times the brothers sit down together, wasting their time talking about things in which there is no benefit at all. This is only a waste of time. And the second point is that the brothers, in their mutual advice, they should not busy themselves with problems that do not concern them. So if there are problems that happen in the East, for example, or calamities to which they can't do anything, from which they can't benefit, and there's no point of them dealing with these problems or talking about them. Why should they bring these problems to them? Rather, they should always try to pick up the good things from the Muslims in the East or wherever they are. Then the Shaykh mentioned the last means that help the Muslim adhere to the Sunnah and remain steadfast upon it, which is to be proud of his religion, to be proud and happy with Islam. And this is why the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, three things, whoever possesses them, then he will taste the sweetness of Iman, is that Allah and His Messenger are more beloved to him than anything else, and that he loves a person, only loves him for the sake of Allah, and that he hates that he returns to kufr, as he hates that Allah throws him into the fire. And these are the characteristics of the one who is proud of his Iman and who is proud of his Islam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by saying, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. Say, O Muhammad, declare it clearly to everyone, this is my way, I call to Allah, without shyness, without reluctance, and without weakness, rather with strength and power and honor and all pride. So this kind of pride with Islam is a psychological one, is a moral one, that reflects on the body, that reflects on our behavior, that reflects on our words, that reflects on our actions. And this is one of the main means that strengthens the Muslim and helps him remain steadfast upon Islam and upon the Sunnah. These are the means that the Shaykh Hafidhullah mentioned, and they are the main ones. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us steadfast upon Islam and proud of our religion wherever we are.